Namaste. Moderator of this session, Dr. Sushant ji, my friend Anirban, Manya Datta ji, many eminent people sitting here on the in the audience, and the Prabuddha participants and intellectuals of this great historic city of Belgavi. I'm really thankful and grateful that I'm called here to speak on this particular topic in this very important city and important campus, which is known in the name of Sir Visveshwaraya. This is a really challenging task, because talking about the journey of Indian democracy and the challenges in the light of reclaiming dignity of Bharat is the challenging task. So what I will try to do is, I will try to put it in some framework that will make our task easier. I'll start with the reference Anirban made about the first constitutional amendment. It was not just about what Shyama Prasad Mukherjee was saying in the parliament and outside the parliament. It was also in response to a particular case that was fought by the Radiance and organizer. And that freedom of speech case, which organizer won in 4 months' time in 1950, the first censorship was imposed in India even before the constitution completely came into operation, and that was used against the organizer. K.R. Malkani ji fought that case tooth and nail and ultimately came out victorious. In response to that, the great democratic liberal Pandit Nehru had to come up with this idea of restricting freedom of speech. But what is more important is the way our democratic journey has been interpreted after that. Like, a person like Anirban also has to refer to so-called Nehruvian consensus. We forget the fact that we became and adopted the democratic form of government immediately after partition, after seeing unprecedented bloodshed. Many people, not just the British, but even the people who carried their intellectual legacy forward in India, were not just predicting, but hoping that one day this will collapse. Many of the bureaucrats have written their memoirs in 49 and 50 with the hope that this democracy will not work. And they have given justification why it will not work. And it worked not because just one party or one person was there, but that ethos was somewhere already existing in this society, which was legally and philosophically articulated in the document called Constitution of India. And remember, it was not a kind of one-way process that was going on in the Constituent Assembly. There were many parallel things that were happening, and those processes were working as a kind of pressure group. Unfortunately, hame ye bhi nahi bataya jata hai ki koi Birla plan tha. हमें यह भी नहीं बताया जाता है कोई गांधी प्लान भी था। हमें यह भी नहीं बताया जाता है कि दीनदयाल जी कंटिन्यूअस एक कॉमेंट्री लिख रहे हैं कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन मेकिंग प्रोसेस पर। हमें यह भी नहीं बताया जाता कि सावरकर ने भी एक प्लान दिया था। और हमें यह भी नहीं बताया जाता है कि मानवेंद्र नाथ रॉय का भी एक प्लान था भारत की आने वाले भविष्य में कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन कैसी हो, डेमोक्रेटिक सिस्टम कैसी हो, हमारी पॉलिटिकल सिस्टम क्या हो। ऑल ऑफ दीज अप्रोचेस वेर हैविंग सम काइंड ऑफ इन्फ्लुएंसेस इन द होल प्रोसेस। सीधे कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली में नहीं हो। एंड माइंड यू, आज के आइडियोलॉजिकल डिस्कोर्स में या तब के भी वन आइडियोलॉजी दैट कंप्लीटली बॉयकॉटेड द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन मेकिंग प्रोसेस वॉज द कम्युनिस्ट आइडियोलॉजी, द ओनली ट्रू अनडिक्लेयर्ड कम्युनिस्ट दैट वॉज एग्जिस्टिंग इन कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली वॉज पंडित जवाहरलाल नेहरू। बिकॉज कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी इसेंशियली बिलीव दैट दिस कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन मेकिंग प्रोसेस इज नथिंग बट द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ अ पर्टिक्युलर क्लास एंड देयर फोर ऑफिशियली दे बॉयकॉटेड इट। सो इफ एनी कम्युनिस्ट इज आस्किंग यू what is your contribution in constitution making process, don't try to ever defend it, don't try to reply it, raise a counter question, show a letter written by Dange against Ambedkar. Now the real you know, there are various ways to look at this journey. Some people like Rajni Kothari has seen this as a, you know, the Congress system era, almost till 1967. First 20 years he defines it as the Congress system. The second phase he says is the Congress dominated system, but emergence of many parties or many models at the state level. So central level it remained the, by and large, the Congress system, but state level, you know, many forces emerge. Then there was a third phase, what he calls as the rise of regionalism, and the fourth phase he says the rise of Hindutva. This is the, you know, way of looking at the journey. Then there are certain legal experts who see this development in terms of the constitutional amendment process and the tussle between the executive and the legislature on the one hand and the judiciary on the other hand, and how we interpreted our constitution. So supremacy of the fundamental rights, then the restoration of balance between fundamental rights and directive principles, then 1973 Keshavananda Bharti case, and the way the basic structure doctrine came, and then the phase of judicial activism. This is another way of looking at our journey. Then there is a traditional way of looking at journey, like this is a Nehru era, this is a Indira era, this is a Vajpayee era, and now we are talking about Modi era. So this is another way of, you know, personality based understanding. I personally feel that if you really want to understand the journey of our democracy, then we have to understand it at the parameters, three parameters, giving different dimensions to the vibrant democratic model that we have evolved. But conceptually, we should understand that there is a continuous struggle, not just between the politics of, you know, alienation and the politics of service, but also between the idea of India and the idea of Bharat. And it was not just in terms of binaries that it existed. Please understand that as far as understanding of Bharat is concerned, there were always three approaches existing even during the freedom struggle. The first approach that Nehru articulated when we got independence, when he said that India is the nation in the making. We have to make a nation. We are making a new nation. And modernity, scientificism, these will be the fundamentals of this new nation. There was a communist approach who believed and still believe that India was never a nation and India will never be a nation. It is a conglomeration of many nationalities which British brought under one rule called the British colonial state. But in India, there was always a journey that was existing, and that is the foundational principle of Indian democracy, which believes that the model of state or model of government kept changing, but as a Rashtra, we have been there, we have been existing, and we will exist. That confidence became the founding stone of our new democratic structure. For the journey of last 70 years is basically to reassert that Rashtriya Bharatiya identity in different ways. Unfortunately, the Nehruian state always undermined this Rashtriya identity, and that's why we find this struggle between the state and the Rashtra. But still, being Bharat, being Hindu ethos, we have evolved new mechanism to develop consensus. As I said, we shouldn't forget that despite all these differences, despite poverty, education, even people like Deen Dayal ji used to say that, you know, the first task in this kind of democracy is to educate the masses. My experience on the ground says the kind of political acumen that illiterate person has in India, the political understanding he has or she has, is much, much better than many of the educated people in India. And that's why we see, you know, historic changes, revolutionary changes through democratic methods, through elections. This is a great success story. The kind of social transformation that we have achieved in last 70 years, tell me a single country where the caste, the linguistic, the regional, all other differences and disparities existed of such a scale. And those were, I wouldn't say completely resolved, but drastically reduced without any kind of civil war. Through constitutional and democratic methods, we have achieved this. Thirdly, the amount of technological and economic transformation that we have gone through, it's also a great success story. And consistently, we are moving ahead. More importantly, the kind of democratic institutions that we have created, nurtured. You know, most of the newly independent country or the countries that are going into the democratic experiment of electioneering, the Election Commission of India is considered as the best, you can say, a guide or a rule book. That is also a success story. And that success story is not just of one person or one constitution or one document. It is the success story of Bharat. It is the success story of people of Bharat. But if we really want to understand this journey in the course of reclaiming our dignity as Bharat, in the context of challenges that we have been facing, then we have to see this journey with a different perspective also. And I would just focus on 3 points. The first one is the institutional point, the institutional part of democracy. The second is the distributive part of democracy. And third and most important is the substantive part of democracy. There is one important incident which is narrated by Dattopan Thengdi in one of his speeches. After discussing about India's democracy with Pujani Sri Guruji, Guruji suggested 2 important points. He said, you know, see, we have to focus on one aspect, that there should not be just representative democracy, it should be also a functional representative democracy. It should not be just proportional representation, but it should be also functional representation. People coming from various professions should be represented in the decision-making process. But more importantly, Sri Guruji insisted that the lowest unit of democracy should be elected through the method of consensus and not election. Political parties and election cannot be the sole method of democracy. Dattopanji discussed the entire issue, came back, and he was discussing this with one of his communist friends, that the lowest unit of our democratic model should be through consensus and not through election. And his immediate response, being a communist, was nonsensical. Then Dattopanji, of course, didn't mention Golwalkar Guruji or my point of view. He said, I will just narrate you a story, then you tell your point of view. He said, after, you know, revelation to the Prophet Muhammad Paigambar at the age of 40, after a few years, some people came to him and said, you know, we have a dispute in our village among the followers of Islam. There are 2 groups who have different interpretations and they are fighting among themselves. So you should please come over and resolve the issue. Muhammad Sahib said, see, my age doesn't permit me now, and more importantly, I have said whatever I wanted to, but ultimately you have to, you know, resolve it at your own level. So find your own mechanism. Every village is start calling me to interpret each and every issue, then it will be impossible to spread Islam. So those people said, you know, you tell us the mechanism, because there are already 2 groups. And they are not ready to, you know, accept others' point of view. What should be done? So Muhammad Sahib suggested that, you know, you select one Amir amongst yourself. It's not Amir, Amir. And who is Amir? A respected elderly person jis par sab har koi vishwas karta, wo jo kahega wo sahi hoga, aisa vishwas ho, aisa ek Amir select karo, jis par dono groups ek tarah se unka confidence ho. Immediately that communist friend of Dattopanji said, "Oh, there is some element of truth in this." And Dattopanji said, "Okay, so if Golwalkar says this is nonsensical, if Mohammad Paigambar says there is an element of truth." That is what we are saying. The lowest model should be through consensus, through confidence, not through division. And this is not only Sri Guruji saying. If you see Sri Rajgopalachari, if you see M.N. Roy, if you see Gandhi, everybody is saying that we cannot sort out each and every issue through electioneering, because ultimately it is going to divide the society on party lines. And if the lowest unit is divided, then entire edifice of democracy is based on division. The corollary to this is the entire majority-minority question to which Anirban was referring to. About that also, there is one important reference by Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. He was chairman of the Committee on Minority Affairs in the constitution-making process. He has written a very apt and brief, to-the-point introduction to his report on minority affairs, where he said, as per the 1935 Act, because Britishers have created this majority and minority differentiation, for another 10 years maybe we have to continue with this and we have to keep certain provisions in the constitution. But the ultimate goal of all these provisions should be to get rid of this majority-minority business. There is a clear-cut vision of the Minority Affairs Committee while proposing the provisions to the Constituent Assembly. We have forgotten that. So, at institutional level, we have created institutions, but the institutions are based on the democracy. And again, Dattopanji has beautifully explained that. See, there are two words, and we adopt generally the wrong connotation of the European terminologies or American terminologies. Because the entire debate between the British democracy and the American democracy was based on the unitary democracy and the federal democracy. And when our debate started, two important suggestions came. One came from the Kanchi Shankaracharya, where he suggested Nehru, which obviously Nehru neglected. He said, after gaining freedom, our goal should be to attain real independence. Two important words used by a rishi. We have attained freedom, we have gained freedom, but now we have to strive to attain independence. Then there was a second suggestion that had come, in which it was specifically said that institutionally, politically, if we really want to make this democracy vibrant and substantive, then decentralization should be our model and not centralization. But we see institutionally we have created centralized mechanisms. I see this experiment of Prabuddha Bharat going away from Luton's Delhi or Bangalore Litfest and coming down to cities like Belagavi or what happened recently in Mangaluru is nothing but the manifestation of real Bharat. Institutionally, we are creating new intellectual vibrant models of democracy. Secondly, at distributive level, we certainly have achieved many things. But again, the model of distribution that we have created through centralized planning instead of localized resource mobilization. Again, it has created a problem, and that's why we are still talking about the so-called issues of distributive justice and social justice. But more important issue for me is the majority-minority and the substantive part of democracy. As I was referring to, the debate was going on between the federal and the unitary, and the word that was suggested by people like K.M. Munshi in the Constituent Assembly was ekatma, which again Dindayalji used. Unfortunately, Pandit Nehru, being mainly with colonial language and colonial mindset, he translated ekatma to unitary and not integral. Unitary is a British model. British model where central authority is the main governing authority. That's why Babasaheb Ambedkar also has to come up with the clarification that I am saying Indian Union and not Indian Federation, because there was a genuine fear of, you know, the separatist tendency. So there was a need for a centralized government. But what should be the power of central government, and what kind of power should be delegated to the states and the lower institutions of democracy? I think conceptually we could not give the understand the substance of integral model of democracy. All the prominent thinkers of that period talks about integral form of democracy. What we are seeing today, the transformation that is happening, where the key decision making in terms of economy or finance, communication and defense is highly centralized, but when it comes to transferring the benefits of resource mobilization or resource generation is getting slowly but surely decentralized. Moving into that direction is the real model of Bharat, real model of Bharatiya democracy. And therefore, we need to understand that when we say the model of governance, the proportional, the functional, the consensual, all these aspects are to be taken into consideration if we really want to connect to the ethos to which Sushantji was talking about. Then that is the real strength. If that edifice is Bharatiya, what is reflecting even in the center will automatically become Bharatiya. Otherwise, we will be caught in the question of binaries, either this or that. We are forgetting slowly that there are multiple levels that can coexist and integrate with each other, and that is idea of Bharat. Reviving that idea of Bharat through a democratic process is the real challenge. I believe such intellectual exercises will germinate certain ideas and institutional mechanisms to pave a way for evolving a model of integrated democracy for Bharat. Thank you. Thank you again for this opportunity.